Mishima starts the book as something in between a criticism and a confession, and he calls it a confidential criticism. But to me, it read more something in between a manifesto and a diary. A manifesto about
the metaphysical philosophy of taking big thing, rising it, and putting it down, and this cures depression. That's about the shape of it, more or less, but it is part of a manifesto about the relationship between a man and his body.
It was a very personal recollection of Mishima and his own past.
There is also a diary in that he's talking about his personal exploration.
Mishima published this in 1970.
He was born in 1925, died in 1970.
He published this not long before committing suicide during a failed coup attempt.
It was a bit of a performance art moment, because I don't think he ever had any hope of actually succeeding in overthrowing the elected government of Japan in doing that. But he felt like what he would do and what he would say would impress that moment into the nation's memory. And I suppose in that he completely succeeded. Although, you know,
this book is dripping with the fact that he was looking for a cause to die for, and that he has been having this view, and he's been looking for a cause to die for a very long time. He goes into a great deal on this, that he finds the death of an Achilles a lot more noble, and finds no interest at all in the death of an old person in a hospital or something like that.
Not only a cause to die for, but to die for beautifully. That is a point he goes on a lot. A beautiful death, he even says like at 40 a man can't die a beautiful death anymore.
He needed a classical body in order to die a romantic.
He views himself as being shaped by words, as that there was something essentially somewhat wrong with him, that he came to know the world first through words and not through physicality, not through action.
It's working out as learning a new language too, and at some point in that he gets into contact with reality, with his physicality that he had neglected.
He's not saying don't be educated. He comments on how some of the kamikaze that he admired, they didn't have masculine bodies either, but that didn't make them less manly, less beautiful.
There's this one passage where he speaks about reading the poems written by a kamikaze pilot, and he basically says that what's striking is how words fail this person. And he keeps coming back to this theme that, in his view, words are a shadow of reality in a way. And thus, the honest kamikaze pilot who knows that he will die in a few hours oftentimes finds that they go forward with a certain energy and vigor, but they struggle to have anything to say about it. And they struggle to say anything poetic about it.
Do you think that he saw more beauty in action than in speech, you would say?
Oh, definitely, beautiful. Definitively, and yeah. I think most relevantly, I think he saw most beauty in death, in the act of dying. But if it feels like he's getting at the idea that it's at that pinnacle where there's nothing else to live for, there's just what's directly ahead of you, that you get somewhat closer to the divine, somewhat closer to the truth, to divination.
I think he will say something like that, because he makes a beautiful example, a beautiful narration in one of the few times he talks about his direct experience more than his impulses, his feeling about looking out. When he talks about this parade in which people are carrying this statue of the Buddha, and the statue is made of bronze, I don't remember exactly, I think bronze, or either bronze or iron, something like that. It's extremely heavy, and he could see ecstasy in the faces of the guys that volunteered to carry the statue, and was inspired into working out in part to be able to have the same experience. And this experience proved itself to be, in short, an experience of mindlessness in a way, in that there were no words to describe it.
He's against individuality. So, for example, when it comes to carrying the statue, one of the points he makes that it's a group activity,
yes,
rather than an individual one, and that
He seems to see the world of the physical as inherently related to, yeah, group activity and having a cause that the group works behind, whereas words by nature is somewhat individual.
He also defends, not propaganda, what's the slogans, the language of slogans, as opposed to the language of an individual voice, of an individual author, let's say.
That has some parallels with traditional Japanese poetry, with haikus. In a way, you will craft a slogan for lots of people to be carried by, to use words, but use words so universally that you wouldn't exist, you the writer wouldn't exist behind them, that all people that read it can get the message, the impression that you want to transmit.
Would you characterize Mishima as a dualist of any kind?
I would, considering that this whole book is about mind-body dualism, so I mean...
Like, it's about mind-body dualism, but in a way it's about how they unite, at least in the act of pumping iron. In a certain part, I remember, he talks about that he formed this idea of his body that was fictitious the moment when he started, but... The iron, the sun, and the steel were the mean by which he could approach that ideal that he made for himself.
He describes an idea of, like, he doesn't feel as though that he's grown tremendously in wisdom or knowledge since his teenage years. He doesn't feel as if he's like some brand new person.
He doesn't come off as very humble to me.
I think he is. I mean, he's prideful, obviously, but it's always toward a goal.
He just feels his body has become older, but he was still the same person intellectually.
And he feels dishonored by that? The grip of his youth slipping, and that bothers him.
He's going through a midlife crisis, maybe.
He seems to have a generally pretty low opinion of a certain class of intellectuals, let us say.
A physique checks the people who criticize hero worship.
He basically says, I have never seen anyone who was physically adept who actually hated hero worship. Here's the quotation. The cynicism that regards all hero worship as comical is shadowed by a sense of physical inferiority. Invariably, it is the man who believes himself to be physically lacking in heroic attributes who speaks mockingly of the hero. And when he does so, how dishonest it is that his phraseology, partaking ostensibly of a logic so universal and general, should not, or at least should be assumed by the general public not to, give any clue to his physical characteristics. I have yet to hear hero worship marked by a man endowed with what might justly be called heroic physical attributes. Facile cynicism, invariably, is related to feeble muscles or obesity, while the cult of the hero and a mighty nihilism are always related to a mighty body and well-tempered muscles. For the cult of the hero is, ultimately, basic principle of the body, and in the long run is intimately involved with the contrast between the robustness of the body and the destruction that is death. Now, I find that interesting because modern isekai anime is so overwhelmed with this facile, really childish cynicism to it, of exactly the type he talks about there. And okay, anime is less serious.
Do you mean they're trying to deconstruct a JRPG hero?
You know, the zero, such thing as those, like, you, we can't have a cool hero.
Do you think that Mishima can be criticized for not knowing how to age gracefully?
People of similar disposition to him, such as Okakura Kakuzo, yeah, he lacks a bit of virtue in that regard. In part, he got fooled by the image he made of himself and thought he would build himself up with sun and steel and discovered the inevitable reality that things rot, the rot consumes. The third law of thermodynamics has no escape. It's beyond words and it's beyond the body. He doesn't express that poetically, didn't think about that, didn't argue with himself about that.
He just compared that to the ultimate opponent in martial arts.
As long as you don't end up doing seppuku in an armory after a failed coup attempt.
How much do you think Mishima would have fit in ancient Athens or ancient Sparta?
Well, ancient Sparta, spiritually perfect. He would have been only as a kid. He would have straightened himself out pretty quickly because he started as a little nerd. He wouldn't have much okay to be swayed by word if he was born in Sparta. If he was born in Athens, he would probably have become pretty similar to what he actually became.
Mishima had a certain interest in ancient Greece.
One of the things which contributed to him starting bodybuilding was going to Greece to see the statues over there. What were you going to say about that art critic?
Okakura Kakuzo. He is the author of The Book of Tea. It's a book which I wholeheartedly recommend too, because it is a bit of a mirror reflection to Sun and Steel. It talks about different crafts. One talks about the craft of pumping fucking iron and becoming huge. The other talks about the art of making a perfect tea ceremony. In the end, the feeling that's coming through both is the same feeling as lifting the Buddha statue. If you want to do a tea ceremony, it has to be a perfect tea ceremony. The ritual is made to enhance the attention, the perfection of the execution of everything, which allows the mind to experience something different.
I don't think that Mishima talks about craftsmanship directly.
Not directly, but there is an element of it in the idea of crafting himself that he has.
He was trying to be more Japanese than the Japanese.
Because the Japanese already by that time were decaying and ceasing to be particularly Japanese.
What I mean is, if a modern Englishman tried to live the way that a knight lived.
I don't feel that's comparable, because you look at Mishima when he lived. The Imperial Japanese state, its ethos was essentially a cult of the samurai, especially as they got into the war period, was the idea that the ethos of Bushido, the ethos of the samurai, should be extended to the entire Japanese populace. Something which I'll point out was not how Bushido was. Like, Bushido was confined to the warrior class. So from that perspective, someone like Mishima, who never got to go into the war because of his own health issues, and all of a sudden saw all these ethos just get abandoned all of a sudden, as if they had never existed. It's only natural.
It's just that I've read other Japanese authors who came before Mishima, like Natsume Soseki and Osamu Dazai and Anko Sakaguchi, and even though they came before Mishima, they sounded more modern for some reason.
Yeah, no, the war was undoubtedly a renaissance of returning to some of those older ideals.
What is more surprising then is how the rest of Japan was very easily able to walk off it.
There were essentially two responses to the surrender by the emperor. There was a reaction of grief, and for the others, there was a feeling of betrayal, that we didn't have to continue on this suicidal path for so long, and yet we were told there was no choice. And that led, especially in the nascent left-wing movements, a deep, deep distrust of authority in Japanese society.
This book is also about the appreciation of manly beauty. Mishima comments how there needs to be danger in order for male beauty to be appreciated. Otherwise, without the risk of that, it's just ridiculous. You can see it in how, but some people view bodybuilding in particular as vain and ridiculous.
I wanted to say something. I've noticed some parallels between this and Evola's thought of the whole warrior class being the dominion of society. Like, everything has to be centered around this martial aspect, that we must completely remake all of society into this strict, militaristic, masculine ideal. And if we can't do that, we failed completely.
Mishima is very much getting at that, and historically, Imperial Japan, especially during the war years, was an attempt to inculcate that in the entire adult male population.
Mishima lived for that.
I'd say that is correct. What did you think of the epilogue he has where he speaks of going up in the F-104? He saw this fusion of the mechanical towards the body as something like his ideal, and then he ends it with Poem of Icarus.
This is a theme that we find in Italian futurism, in books like Fajada, the Futurist, from Filippo Tommaso Marinetti. You could say proto-transhumanism, but of a becoming. This epilogue from Mishima is pretty much in line with that, I will say. Machine of technology being not simply a mean, but a subject, allowing the expression of the person itself. In itself. This is in line also with what Mishima says before in the book, when he talks about embodying words, spiritualizing his body, saying that his muscular is slowly taking into an abstract quality of their own, in the sense, you could say evolution, but it would be selling the idea that he's expressing short, I think.
At the start, when he talked about those men carrying the statue, he speaks about the sky, which those men, and he himself as a boy, as he watched them, like how they could all see that beautiful sky. And well, it sort of ends with him going to the sky. So I thought it was.
It's a nice parallelism between the start and the end of the book.
There was an unexpected metaphor in that bit about the jet, how he felt like the spermatozoa are being ejaculated.
Let's say the sperm cell. Yeah. I don't think anyone can say that Mishima was 100% perfectly straight man, but it is very reductive in turning Mishima into an LGBT icon